Tron.
When I saw this movie, 1985, this really changed my life, because I then committed my professional career to artificial intelligence. And at this day, I started to learn programming. The first program I wrote was on this computer. And it was built meant to be an artificial intelligence. What I did was I programmed a program which was built to foresee the lottery draws. So it ran a whole night, and the next day I bought a lottery ticket, and the day after I won 500 German marks. Wow. So you can see I was very enthusiastic about artificial intelligence. It never happened again. Yes. Actually, the algorithm was built purely on random draws. But I didn't gave up. I started in the early 90s, 1993, to build a stock market prediction system. It took us 5 years to program and to understand how artificial neural networks really work. But at the end, we bet the odds with 60% hit rate instead of 50, like the managers in the rooms in Frankfurt. So, and this is still operational today, so you can buy those predictions. And I also was engaged in my master's thesis, where we forecast whether or not a production part, a fiber optic part, is malfunctioning or not. And this forecast, this prediction, enabled the company, Siemens at that time, to increase its production capacity by 30%. So all that I've done so far at that point was, let me call it, the artificial intelligence as you know it, machine learning as you know it today, and as can be compared with a Google self-driving car. AI today basically automates operative decisions. That's what it does. And all those 100 and more top AI companies are doing the same. They automate, operate decisions, and this is drives great value. But what I was committing later was a different kind of AI. It was an AI which is not a self-driving car. A self-driving car has foresees, okay, there's a crash, I need to brake, I need to go to the right, to the left. It optimizes operative decisions. This kid, I don't know if everyone knows him, this is a car from David Hasselhoff in the 80s, and he is not just a self-driving car, it basically is a consultant on a strategic level. Yeah? He understands what should you do to reach a goal. And you need a different kind of AI for that. Yeah? So it is, and I call that, this is an AI of the second generation, which there's not much buzz today, but what we do as a company since 10 years now, quite successful for big brands. Let me quickly describe where's the difference between conventional AI. Conventional AI is basically that you have an input feature pattern, you have some properties, and you want to predict an outcome. Yeah, maybe the outcome is later in time, then it's a prediction. If it's in the same time, it's a pattern recognition. But basically, you do machine learning to understand the complex unknown function between input and output. You're building a black box. And that's very useful, as we all know. But to understand, to consult David Hasselhoff what he should do, you need to understand what the causal impact of actions are. You need to understand what is the causal impact of that toward that. And what many people don't know is this cannot do that. It only models a part of it. To really understand what an action which influences a certain action or a certain data, what it does really do on the outcome, you need to do more. And the, basically you need to do in the AI of the second generation, you do, let's call it causal machine learning, you need to do three things. First thing is, you not just map input-output relationships, you try to understand how the whole network, what the causal network looks like. So every node, every variable could be an outcome.
Sorry.
Why? Because there are indirect effects. Yeah? You will see later in some examples that the driver, they influence each other. And you need to understand this in order to understand the causal impact. That's the first thing. The second thing you need to do is you need to open up the black box, because the black box is predicting, but it does not tell you what is the theta plus paribus, what is the impact of a certain action. Yeah, is it nonlinear? Is it whatever it is? We need to understand that. We apply simulation techniques to basically measure it, visualize it, and so forth. And there's a third thing you need to do, which is you need to understand the causal direction. In AI, we don't care so much whether or not this is a cause or an indicator or whatever, as long as the prediction works on test data, basically, right? But if you do a causal network, it makes a very great difference if you have the causal direction in a different way. And we have algorithms for that to test causal directions. Let me give you just a small feeling for that. What you see here on the left is X causing Y, with some noise. Okay. What you see on the right is the same data, just flip side. Okay. And the thing is that if you fit Y with X, you get the same explanation power, the same variance explanation as fitting Y with X with Y. So this means machine learning cannot tell you in its form, in its normal form, what's the correct causal direction is. You need to apply other techniques. That's what we do. We build a network. We open up the black box, and we care for causal directions. And if you do that, you can measure what is the importance of certain actions towards the outcomes. And actually, this is quite fuzzy, but now let's get concrete. Certain actions, in businesses, we do, for instance, advertising or calling a customer. This is an action. How impactful will it be to drive sales? The same is for soccer. Yeah? When I change the players, if you do have more defenders, it's an action. What will be the outcome towards that? For instance, will we score more goals if we do short passes, if we have vertical passes, and so forth? These are all questions. What are the causal impact of actions? This is what the causal machine learning is evaluating. And why do we need that? Do you know Moneyball?
Yes.
As most of you know, it's basically a Hollywood movie around the statistical revolution that took place in the 70s around baseball. So they really understood the power of analyzing data. Unfortunately, soccer is much more complex than baseball. It's really a very dynamic game. And that's why today, the in the boardrooms and the, in the management rooms of soccer clubs, it still looks like in the 70s, like in the Moneyball video. Look at that.
Who do you like?
I like Perez. He's got a classic swing. He's a real clean stroke.
You can't hit the curveball.
Well, there's some work to be done, I'll admit that, yeah, but he's noticeable.
And an ugly girlfriend.
What's that?
Ugly girlfriend means no confidence.
Okay.
This guy's got an attitude is good. I mean, he's the kind of guy who walks into a room, his dick has already been there for 2 minutes.
Yes. He's got the looks, he's ready to play the part. He just needs to get some playing time.
I'm just saying, his girlfriend is a six at best.
Plus, if we're trying to replace him.
Decisions are based on plausibility and storytelling. And this is the case in management today as well. Yeah. They don't have evidence-based techniques to really understand what is the causal effect of actions. So that's why we took the data of the soccer teams and analyzed what can we learn from those data. To understand the Bundesliga soccer clubs today, they have all a tag, a chip, and they have data where you know for every millisecond at which place at the field they are at any time. On top of that, there are little students coding every second when, for instance, there is a headshot, if there is a corner ball, if there's a fault, there's a student pushing the button, so it is all coded what actually qualitatively happening on the ground. This data we took, and of course it's so much data, you need to pre-process that in a way that we can learn something from that. For prediction, it's not so relevant to really pre-process that in a way that it is meaningful. But for causal machine learning, it is. Because we want to derive actionable recommendations out of that. So what did we do? We took basically the stream of time series data and sliced it. So typically the play is sliced in actions. If I shoot the ball, it's an action. Someone gets it, it's another action. Someone does a fall, it's another action. So it is sliced in actions with typically 1 second after another. And this is our slicing, asynchronous slicing, and every moment is described by a lot of criteria. The criteria is the situation, what's the speed of the player, what was happening in the past, how long did the player have run, what other players are around, can I pass the ball of the ball? Has the other player enough time to accept the ball and so forth? So we have a lot of criteria which describes the situation. And then we can understand using causal machine learning how this pattern is useful to predict intermediate results. Outcomes is, for instance, a goal. Yeah. This is what we did. So we wrote 150 pages of software code, pre-processing those kinds of data. Outcomes are if you shoot at the goal, if you have a good shooting angle, which is basically have a good chance of hitting the goal and so forth. So there's a context. Actions, intermediate outcomes are, for instance, if you advance towards a goal, or if you gain so-called space time. Space time is the time where the opponents need to reach you. Yeah. If you are standing here and the opponent is there, he will be quite fast here, but if we all moving, this time will be different, yeah? Because if I'm already running very fast in that direction, he takes much more time to reach him, right? So this can be all computed out of those data. And actually, with descriptive data analytics, you basically cannot really explain outcomes. You could do by conventional statistics and applying machine learning, increase the validity, statistical validity by factor 3. But more interestingly, what did we learn? I brought today some sample outcomes, not the whole ones, but just to give you a small taste. What you see, for instance, it's not a scatter plot. Huh? It's a sorry for German language, but basically, what is the time the player has the ball? If the player in time 2 always plays it along, so doesn't have a long time holding the ball, the likelihood to goal is much higher. So basically, in front of the goal, typically tiki-taka, which is basically always giving the ball always to someone else, never do your dribbling by yourself close to the goal, the likelihood of goaling is much higher. One finding. As I said, this is not a scatter plot, this is the simulated causal effect of this onto this. It's a difference. Because scatter plots will give you clouds of dots. Right? Another thing, what's the time towards the goal end? So this is the beginning of the game, this is the end. And here you see basically the shooting angle. So in the first 50 minutes, the shooting angle is 2% higher. So it's much better. It's likelihood to hit the goal is better in the first 50 minutes. There's another finding we had, which speaks for the importance of the beginning of the game. This is how the score is. This is even. This is you. You are in favor. This is the opponent has more goals, and this is the space time. So the space time of your colleague, basically. So typically, you want to have colleagues with a lot of space time so that you can shoot an interesting pass, so he can have a good chance of shooting at the goal. So we see that. Basically, the best space time we have if the goals and the scores are even. This is intuitive. Yesterday, for instance, there was a goal. Now the game opens up. Yeah, but the statistics tell something different. Basically, the chances of goal hitting the goal is higher when there is even, because then nobody has the incentive to really protect his game. Yeah, everyone needs to win. So at the beginning of the game, it's always even, right? So the beginning of the game has a really important part. Two more insights here. What we found is, what I also have never saw in, for instance, in television, that we found that really the defender, they have a key role. Why? Because space time is a very critical variable, basically. Yeah, that the man with the ball has space time to advance and to shoot, basically. But space time typically decreases in middle field and in front of the goal. It's very, very, you have a few seconds and it's away. Yeah? But the defender with smart passes, they create space time. So a typical football move on average lasts 7 to 10 seconds. Yeah? So having or starting a football move with a great pass from the defender is critical to generate interesting chances. Last insight, we found a very interesting shooting angle, because if the shooting angle here is high, you have a higher chance of hitting the goal, but you have a lot of defenders in front of you, right? And here's the opposite, not so many defenders, but bad shooting angles. But there seems to be an optimum in this corridor. I brought to you now two examples that illustrate the importance of this corridor.
Sie haben so viel an Standards gedriftet.
But I brought you another example.
Yeah.
So you see, it's quite valuable to apply evidence-based approaches, applying artificial neural networks, even on those soccer data. And actually, we applied those approaches before in businesses. So we took our methodology where we try to understand strategic moves for businesses, and took that into soccer. And I'd like to give you now some examples how the same methodology drives value for businesses, for companies. Because the boardroom looks pretty much the same as in Moneyball. Everyone is bullshitting, basically. And okay, they would say, no, we don't bullshitting. Argue fact-based, right? I give you an example how this works. Fact-based management. Fact-based management, these are facts. This is our facts from a lottery provider. So the lottery provider looks at the frequency of their data, right? So they see senior people are more likely play lottery. That's what the data shows. That's a fact. What do they learn? They learn, okay, this is our target group because they play more lottery, right? Sounds logical. And they built the whole storytelling around this finding. However, this is a spurious correlation. If you take the data behind that and build, use machine learning, causal machining, you learn that the opposite is true. Young people, if everything is the same, young people are more likely to play lottery. This data is right, but the interpretation is wrong. There's a different reason for the same facts. This reason is that the main reason for playing lottery is ritualization and experiencing of winning. And this comes with the age. If I am older, I'm getting older, sometimes I play lottery, I like it, I do it just every week, as we ritualize many things. And sometimes I win. So this will help me to play again. So basically, this is why older people play lottery, but not because they are prone to it. And I could... I wrote a book about it. Basically, there are hundreds of those stories. If you look at facts, you get fooled by spurious correlations. That's why you need causal machine learning to understand what's a true causal driver, what's a true driver of businesses are. So give you a few examples. 95% of new products in the supermarket will disappear. So basically, companies, big brands, Nestle with 100 billion of revenue, they're just guessing, they make a product, they like it, they do market research, but mostly they fail. Yeah. We recently took some data, basically new products are surveyed with 100 people, and you get some information about the product. We were able to build a causal success model to consult companies how success evolves, and we took the same thing to predict whether or not a product will be successful, and we get 85% hit rate. So this is a typical example which will save a lot of money for the companies, right? Another example, yeah.
But if 95% of products fail, you could just predict fail every time and get a 95% hit rate.
That's right. That's right. But this is on the, this is on the on both sides. So
right. Yeah. On this.
Good point. Other example: every company, typically, or many companies, do NPS service. NPS is basically they ask, "Are you likely to recommend us?" Yeah. And what they typically do, they ask from point from 1 to 10, "Are you likely to recommend and why?" Text input. Then they count what they say. Yeah. And they believe the most likely, most often, frequently answered answer is a reason. But actually, it turns out that this is not the case. I recently heard that the most often reason for divorce is lack of order and in a home environment. Yeah? But I would bet this is just what people say, but it's not the true driver of divorce. So I'll give you an example. We used AI on two levels. I'll show you now how. But basically found that for an insurance company, the most often reason what they mention is great customer service. But actually what turns out that the impact which the AI, the machine learning finds is something which is not so often mentioned. It is trust, honesty, reliability. If someone mentions that, it really drives loyalty. It is a true reason for being loyal. This is what you can learn out of data by not just looking at data. And this is how it works, basically on two levels. We have two data, huh? Two types of data. We have the NPS score and with unstructured text data. And we use natural language processing with, and basically predict categories. We quantify a few hundred answers, and then it can answers and quantifies automatically thousands of things with a pretty much the same accuracy. And these categories we use to predict, to understand what drives loyalty. Oops, another application is advertising. Advertising is really qualitatively emotional. How can we apply AI to give guidance here, what works and what don't? And I would like to give you now a very emotional example, because it is believed by the creatives and the advertising agencies that emotion really drives impact.
Hallo Papa, ich bin's. Ich wollte nur kurz anrufen und dir Bescheid geben, wir werden es Weihnachten dieses Jahr wieder nicht schaffen. Wir versuchen es nächstes Jahr und dann klappt es ganz bestimmt. Fröhliche Weihnachten, Papa. Bis bald.
Thank you. I don't know which one
is. It's, well, it's Islam.
Oh, okay.
Ja, einige, einige haben, treten ja auch, warum zeige ich das? English. So, why I'm showing you that? I'll show you that you can feel the opinion of the decision makers in the companies, in the marketing departments. They see such a spot and they feel, this is a great spot. This really, this is emotional. This is so engaging, yeah? So it must be good. It is fantastic. This is what you feel. The issue is that what you feel is not what really works. And this spot actually didn't work. The marketing director was fired 4 weeks later. And we found why. Because we built a large study over different categories. We tested hundreds of ads in an online survey. We measured the emotional response of people. There are different 7 basic emotional types. We measured what it does to their brand love and to their purchase intention. And we did more. We described objectively what is happening in a spot. There are 200 different criteria where we could say, okay, it's a spokesperson, there is a singing cell, there is a certain emotional basic message, and so forth. Objectively described. And the AI now understands what are the objective drivers. Is a celebrity working, for instance? What does it do to emotion, and how do they work to drive sales? And what we found are many things. Beside one is basically that happiness is basically the core driver of impact of an advertising. It doesn't mean that a spot needs to be funny. It doesn't mean that it must be just a nice world. It needs to leave you with a happy feeling. There are different types of happiness, but basically, the spot you saw leaves you with sadness, and the Stone Age brain in yourself wants to run away from bad, negative emotions. This is what you can show with AI learns out of those data. So even if you want to teach something in a spot, you need to engage them with some relevant content. You need to inspire some kind of happiness.
You brought the example. This example was very popular. Everybody knows it. And you said it was a failure?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah.
I even remembered Edeka at the end.
Yeah, but have you bought by Edeka afterwards?
No.
there are even many more. Advertisings that one can and so forth, because can is judged by a jury, which also likes this kind of spots. But we can measure what it does to sales.
Okay.
Last example before I come to the end. 5 years ago, there was the US daughter of T-Mobile. They were making losses and they hired a new CEO, which basically changed the strategy. They eliminated contract terms, gave a flat rate, lower flat rates, and free iPhones on top. And they called it, we are now the Robin Hood of the industry, basically, yeah? They did a new communication campaign, and a customer loved that, but they didn't know why. What of those moves are really the cause for customers to come? That was when they called us. And we took their brand tracking data, and use causal machining on top of that. The answer to this question was so important because everything they did is easily copied. You can change contract terms, prices, devices on top. You can do that in a minute and copy them, right? So that's why we analyzed that, and we found out that the nothing of them, those moves, was a direct reason for driving sales. It was their story. It was their Robin Hood story, changing wireless for the better. We are not a mobile carrier, we are the uncarrier. This was so emotional story that was reasoned by those moves. So basically, if you eliminate the contract term, this is the perfect reason why this storyline is true. So what we recommended was invent new kinds of features that support the storyline. This is what they called the uncarrier moves. They implemented, for instance, global free roaming, which is not so expensive, but it's a perfect illustration that they are the Robin Hood of the industry. And since then, they are growing. They are now doubling market share, threefold stock inflation, and record profits, as you might heard of. So applying evidence-based approaches could be quite valuable.
Do you consider including data of what the competitors are doing? Because the hatred for Verizon and AT&T is enormous.
Yes.
And when you see somebody smaller coming up and doing the right thing.
Yeah. That's exactly why this positioning was so powerful. And it was not the rational things they did, it was the storyline behind that, which really was impacting the whole thing.
And what data was this based on?
This is a brand tracker. It is a survey. So basically it asks for all those things and asks for if they know that they have a device on top of, if they know that the price is low and so forth. So these kind of things we do for many brands to help them be more successful. So I hope I gave you some interesting examples that illustrate that the new type of AI is quite useful. It's useful for businesses. It is also and would be useful for soccer clubs, governments, and even societies, as we all have all big challenges in our society. We do actions, and we need to drive actions as societies, which should drive favorable outcomes, right? And if you are interested in the topic, send me an email to buckler@successdriver.com. I can send you the ebook. This is in German and in English, so there's an English version, The End of the KPI Illusion. It illustrates in a non-mathematical way why it's important, how it works. Thank you.